This morning in the closet, I'm talking to designer Layla Jacobs about your latest range and your choice of textiles, which is always really, really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're choosing fabrics,
yep.
What guides you?
I always use natural fibres, so that's generally the base for decision making. Just guides me. The feel, the smell sometimes.
Right.
And where it comes from is becoming more and more important to me as well and to my customers.
Yeah. So your colour palette is quite neutral, and then you've got what I love, you've got the black, but you've also got the blue alternative that suits people with my sort of colouring.
Yeah, for this season, I've worked in this colour before, sort of that shade. Yeah, it's like an East Client blue, but I've called it azure. It's not quite East Client blue, this blue, but it's got a great, you know, sort of pop to it.
Yeah.
And then the grey and black. I usually just have generally three colourways collections. Like you can see over there, that's next season, and that's just got the peachy tone in it.
Oh yeah, the blush.
Yeah, the blush colour.
Right.
And that's coming for next summer, so that's a different range.
And you've got the paper cotton mix.
So that's like all hand knitted as well.
Right.
Yeah.
And linen.
Mm-hmm.
And wool.
That's a cotton linen blend.
Oh, cotton linen.
Yeah, but I do have wool.
But it feels like wool.
I know it's got a real merino sort of feel to it, but that's why it's trans-seasonal, so it's a summer, it's for summer and for winter.
Ah.
It works well for spring and autumn, for instance, like in between.
Right. Oh, that's right. It has got a real merino feel.
Yeah, it just has the two colourways, so there's the grey colourway. And the black colour over there.
Yeah.
But I do have a wool actually that I've been working in for a couple of winters now, and that's a New Zealand possum merino silk blend.
Yeah. And that would be really, really warm.
Oh, it's incredible. And yeah. It's all New Zealand apart from this one of silk. It's a completely New Zealand fibre.
Because the possum is has incredible properties.
And it's light.
Yeah.
So it's like my favourite fibre at the moment to work in.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I guess, you know, taking what we have as a New Zealand piece and moving it into a wearable garment is a great thing to begin with. But then the lightness and the warmth that it delivers as well.
Mm.
There is some few sample bits actually done.
Thanks
for the
look.
Yeah, I can get this good. I hold it back. This has a 25% possum, and then the rest is merino and silk. But my new blend that's coming has 40% possum, and then the rest merino and silk. Yeah.
So is that that's. I was going to say, it feels a little bit like lens wool.
Yeah.
Rather than merino.
Yeah, might be the possum in it. Just,
Beautiful, beautiful colour.
Yeah.
So how do you wear this piece?
This is a wrap, so actually it's basically a blanket, but you can put your arm in one side here and then wrap it around you like that.
Oh, I think I need this.
Yeah, it's a cool piece, but then there's long jersey dresses and then crops and beanies and fingerless gloves and socks as well.
All in the same?
Yeah, all in this yarn and in black as well.
Right. So in terms of sourcing fabrics, where do you get, that's obviously New Zealand blend, where do you get most of your fabrics from?
All over. Like I work with Walls Weavit, which is our local importer, and get a bit of linen through them, and then I import my silk. Generally, my silk is coming from China at this stage, I mean, most silks, even if you're buying them locally, you're going to find them coming from China or India. So then I've just changed my supplier of my linen from over to a Lithuanian company, which just is doing a great job. You know, I guess I am moving more into natural fibres is not quite enough. It's where you've got natural fibres being made, and who is making them, how are they treating the people that, you know, the companies that
they're,
and are they delivering on a, you know, are they using, delivering a recycled fabric as well through their mill? That's quite important because of, floor scraps,
the waste.
You know, and are they consciously thinking about dry dyeing, or, you know, are they conscious about the movements, or are they just, you know, running the same standard that's not, you know, not working for us?
So does that sort of nudge you more into more boutique mills?
Yes, I guess it does, but then they are, even the bigger mills are moving more into these things as well. For their own, you know, economy, for their own environmental reasons, as well as market reasons too.
So it's that market demand that's pushing that change.
Yeah. And we demand it, so they have to produce it. So it's a joint effort.
So is it a knock-on thing? Is it that the customers want it, and then so the designers deliver it, and so the designers push back through these supply chains? Is that how you see it?
I think it does work like that a lot. Not for me. I think for me it's much more personal, and I don't. It's not about the customer demand necessarily. I do think more and more it's the designer's responsibility to not only design clothing, but to make sure that they're thoughtful about that, and so their consumer is then. Feels even better in the cloth, I guess, than, you know, not only the garment looking good, but the story behind it, and that they can know that it's actually.
So they can rely on you that.
Yeah, they can rely on you.
From you, it's going to be sourced ethically.
Well, as much as we can.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, you know. I think more and more now how far can you go, you know. I'm just thinking about my next winter collection. I'm like, you know, do I wipe out everything that I've been doing in regards to dyeing processes and just focus on dry dyeing or not dyeing at all and just using natural cloth? You know, so these things go through the brain, but how much we can deliver on that is another thing.
But also the incremental improvements, aren't they?
Yeah.
You take a step, and then you take another step.
And
as
so you have to be brave as a designer to make that move as well, because it's going to be harder, it's going to be more expensive, it's going to be, you know, so this is going to actually probably be more tricky for the business to, at this point, without the knowledge and the care and the support of the consumer.
I noticed that you don't dye your hair,
like
me. And mine came out of watching that documentary, River Blue, about the dyeing and these less regulated...
As we said, hair in blue.
Yeah. But I felt like for me, because...
We're great.
it was something that I could actually personally reduce my... dies, but because the River Blue, this documentary shows these communities, dire communities in quite deregulated societies in Pakistan and Bangladesh, and all these quite often quite toxic dyes going into their waterways, and how that affects the community in terms of their health outcomes and their living environment. And I thought the one thing that I could do was to stop, you know, putting dye into our waterways every month. I was getting my head in. And I noticed you. So what prompted you to stop dyeing or not dyeing your hair? Or have you?
I haven't dyed for years, but yeah, I think I just stopped, I guess, maintenance factor and
well, cost comes into it.
Yeah. And also, it's not. I don't think it's so good for you. You know, the dyes going into your skull.
So, so choices around not dyeing your hair was health.
Yeah, I mean many factors. I guess, yeah, health factors and just maintenance factors. And I like the idea of being grey, so, and embracing age and not fighting against it, so.
Yeah, in a way we've kind of been brainwashed by the L'Oreal's, etc. that
yeah.
you must dye your hair.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was that kind of...
And but each to their own, you know, and there is good dyes out there now for people to work with. I mean, the hair company that I do a lot of work with, the shows and fashion shows, they are very, very good with their dyes and what they use and how they process it and where it goes. And yeah, so it's very thoughtful. So, yeah.
Oh, that's good,
Shani. Yeah, that's Colleen. Just
now. Oh, we saw that. I took a photo because my mother's name is Colleen, so I just took a photo of them to see to So yeah, the dye question is really interesting because of the impacts of it can be so massive.
Mm.
And but then, you know, this is such an amazing colour. How can you not be drawn to it?
Yeah, but I am very interested in the different techniques of dyeing, like dry dyeing. There's a new, you know, people and companies are moving more into the dry dyeing, and so they're. The water, not as much water is being used, and obviously then the toxic releases in there anyway.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. There's so a whole
movements, they're just, you know, getting everyone onto them, and you onto me onto them too, I guess.
Yeah.
This dye is done in New Zealand, so. Because it's a New Zealand product, so fully.
Yeah. Who does the dyeing?
Wool Yarns.
Oh, and Lowell Hutch. Yeah. Oh, okay. I didn't realise they had a dye house at them, but they must do.
Yeah, because they're processing everything.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, we know that, but I've never seen the dyeing. Have you seen the dyeing? Yeah.
They must send it off somewhere to get dyed.
Hmm.
Yeah, because I don't think they've got a dye.
Yeah.
But I imagine that'd be pretty... careful around.
There's probably the more regulations involved with our dyeing processes in New Zealand.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And that's where the, you know, those big environmental impacts are, because the production for often big brands was moved to less regulated countries, and that was really, really exploited.
Mm.
So. Yeah, like if you keep production on shore, like in the States and New Zealand, etc., etc., then there's that cost to, compliance.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this is, getting to a whole other debate.
No, I mean, it's a huge topic, all of it is a massive topic. And it's like, how much time have you got in a day to spend thinking about that, you know?
So
I think I said to you when I was meeting, I feel like a vegan in leather shoes sometimes. You know, because you can do so much, you can be so conscious, but you're always going to slide in certain areas.
Yeah.
Like the industry is essentially a toxic industry. So it's like how much. But we all need gardening at the end of the day too.
Yeah,
so,
I mean,
how much can we do? It's a real. No, so then it falls on the consumer to also be super conscious about where they're putting their dollar and how much use they're getting out of the garments that they're purchasing.
That's a really, that's a great phrase. A vegan in leather shoes. But, I think so much of the industry over the last couple of decades, it's really slid and the exploitation's been massive, but now there's a righting of the ship, and as consumers or as purchasers become more aware of what's going on, I feel like there's a big shift, but there's always going to be an impact to clothing ourselves, and if you're mindful of it, and if you're doing the best that you can, it's never going to be 100% perfect.
Mm.
But, yeah. But it's better than, you know, it's a big scale.
Yeah.
And to me, it looks like you're at the scene, not at that end.
Yeah.
And you give it such thought.
Yeah, I do. Overly at times. Anyway, to a point of detriment, I think. But, you know, there's companies like Hunters and Collectors, you know, for instance, that are really important in our chain system also for sending the product back out again.
For a second or third life,
you know, so that those
recycled,
or, you know, I
shouldn't like that. No, but it's a symbiotic relationship that makes the whole work, because it's, you've got the designers who are producing product, and then the customers that are wearing them, and they'll wear them for a period, and then I like to keep things in my wardrobe for a long time, but I think also as we age, when we're younger, we're really playing with that self-expression, and I think as we get older, often we do less of that reimagining ourselves, or reinventing ourselves, or changing our look, and so products, well, clothing stay in our wardrobes longer, but I do think there's a big section where someone rang me the other day from that recycling secondhand store, saying they've seen a real loss in the quality of the garments coming through because of the predominance of fast fashion. And it's really impacting.
Off shopping's not quite the same.
No, because if you buy really
not at that level anyway.
If you buy really good quality garments like yours to start with, they're going to have much longer lives, and they hold their value much longer.
Yeah, I guess that's where your company comes in, and recycling garments into new cloth. Possibly.
We work on corporate garments because the volumes are, while we're very conscious of our domestic clothing, the volumes in corporate clothing is 40 times greater.
Right.
So it's massive. So we will have...
Are you talking about uniforms?
Uniforms, yeah. Even mostly uniforms. But we had an organisation contact us not long ago, and they were having a rebranding, so they're decommissioning 250,000 garments. Mm. And so that's a scale. So we operate purely in the corporate. But our interest, obviously, that the...
But it's getting made back into cloth? Sorry, I'm saying that.
Oh, no, you are. Is it?
Sorry?
We have done a number of... turning it into upholstery.
Right.
Fabrics.
Yeah.
But now we're looking at technologies. So bringing technologies on shore that you can, we're particularly looking at polyester technology at the moment. So you can put a polyester shirt and get a plastic out the other end that can then go back into, well, it could go back into clothing. And the reason why we're looking at polyester is because it's the 3/4 of corporate clothing is polyester, so we need to do something about that. Yeah. Not because it's a fair, you know.
No, fair risk of choice.
Yeah.
But I guess quite good for the likes of printed materials as well, you know, if you're working with any sort of 3D printing manufacture, you know, that's the gluey stuff, the sticky stuff that could...
You mean put sublimation on that?
The technologies that are available to reuse these garments, but
these are the first stage.
It's interesting to me. Is it outside of this? I don't know, but I'd love to talk more about what technologies you're bringing in and what you're going to do with them.
Yeah.
And even for me, working in natural fibres, there's room for that world. If it's reusing something, you know, especially in accessories, you know, so like I would be interested.
Like you mean gloves and.
Or, yeah, it depends what can you know, the, how solid something can become.
Yeah.
You know, if it's coming from a cloth, I know a poly cloth, but essentially it could then be moved into a more solid form.
Like a molded accessory?
Yeah.
Oh, certainly with the polyesters you can.
Yeah.
Like glasses frames and earrings
that
and
sort of
jewellery.
Yeah, but then, yeah, that's made from recycled uniforms.
Cool. Yeah. Oh, good. They look at the thumbs up.
Awesome. I mean, then there's room totally inside. I mean, natural fibres feel great on the skin for wearing and... Yeah, but I'd love to work more on recycled fabrics, recycled materials.
Mm.
I'm just researching at the moment how to get my hands on recycled yarns for next season.
Right.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah. There's quite a lot becoming available.
Mm.
But you know, we have no, aside from wool, we don't really have a yarn production in New Zealand.
No.
And even spinning.
But growing hemp now, right?
Yeah.
For oils and stuff. So.
And then
we've
had conversations with a couple of the iwis who are looking at hemp production because it's such a restorative crop as well.
It's so great. I'd love to work, you know, summer have that included into ranges and then winter be working with fossil yarn. I'm
a natural girl. I don't like very synthetic textures.
Yeah, that would be ideal. Go even.
Hey, thank you for taking the time to have a chat.
Yeah.
And
yeah, no worries.
Love your work.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.